So welcome to this lecture series on environment and ecology presented by Mentors for IAS in association with Bangalore IAS Academy and Nama KPSC. So in this particular video, we will be discussing about the greenhouse effect and some of the most potent greenhouse gases, as to what are the effects of these greenhouse gases, what are the different sources of these greenhouse gases, and how some of them may be removed from the atmosphere in order to mitigate or combat climate change caused due to global warming. So first we'll discuss about the greenhouse effect. Now, the greenhouse effect is nothing but a process caused by greenhouse gases which occur naturally in the atmosphere. This process plays a crucial role in warming the Earth's surface, making it habitable. See, just as greenhouses, you would have seen greenhouses, say for example in Lal Bagh we have a greenhouse. So just as these greenhouses keep the air warm inside the chamber, similarly water vapor and other greenhouse gases are able to warm the earth or the earth's atmosphere. Greenhouse gases therefore play an important role in the balance of the earth's cooling and warming. According to one of the estimates, if the greenhouse gases were not present in the atmosphere, that is in the absence of naturally occurring greenhouse effect, the average temperature of the Earth's surface would have been minus 19 degrees Celsius instead of the present value of 15 degrees Celsius, and hence Earth would have been a frozen planet without any life form as such. So this greenhouse effect or the greenhouses itself is actually beneficial for the survival or for the benefit of life on Earth. However, the problem is when humans have started to interfere in this natural process or this natural effect. So human generated greenhouse gas emissions upset the natural balance and lead to increased warmth. So you have to understand that the Earth has something known as a natural heat budget. It is when this heat budget is changed due to the presence of these extra greenhouse gases, where these greenhouse gases have been emitted into the atmosphere due to man-made or due to human activities, that is when it actually becomes a problem. So I hope you've understood what is this greenhouse effect. Greenhouse effect is nothing but the warming of the earth due to the emission of more and more greenhouse gases into the atmosphere by human activities. So in order to further understand this, we will be discussing about the incoming energy, absorption, emission, role of greenhouse gases, and the human effect or the human role in all of this. Okay, so the first is we'll discuss about the incoming energy. See, obviously the main source of energy on Earth is what? It is the sun. So the sun emits energy that is transmitted to Earth. Because the sun is very hot, the energy which is transmitted or which is emitted is high energy. It is emitted in high energy but short wavelengths that penetrate the Earth's atmosphere. So in this image here that you see over here, the yellow rays, that is nothing but the sun's incoming energy, it is in the form of short wavelength. Once we receive all this energy from the sun, what happens? Absorption takes place. However, about 30% of the sun's energy is reflected directly back into space by the atmosphere, clouds, and surface of the earth. Out of all the sun's energy that is received by us on earth, only about 70% is actually accepted, is actually absorbed. The remaining 30% is directly reflected back into the space. After 30% is reflected back, the rest of the sun's energy is absorbed into the Earth's system. Then after absorption, we have emission. Once a sufficient amount of sun's energy, that is 70% of the sun's energy, has been absorbed, the Earth will re-emit some of the absorbed energy back. So what I'm trying to say is that the earth will try to re-emit some of the absorbed energy back into the atmosphere. Now, since the earth is cooler than the sun, the energy is emitted in the form of infrared radiations at wavelengths longer than the incoming solar energy. Okay, I hope you've understood this. See, when incoming solar radiation is short wavelength, but when energy is re-emitted back by the earth, it is in the form of longer wavelength. So, what is the role of greenhouse gases in all of this? So, the greenhouse gases in the atmosphere absorb much of the long wavelength energy, that is nothing but infrared radiations emitted by the Earth's surface, therefore preventing it from escaping from the Earth system. See, the energy from the sun is short wavelength. Therefore, these are not absorbed by the greenhouse gases. However, when the same energy is reflected back or is not reflected, sorry, is re-emitted back by the Earth, but in the form of long wavelength, these are now absorbed by the greenhouse gases. The greenhouse gases then re-emit this energy in all directions, warming the Earth's surface and lower atmosphere. So this is the role of greenhouse gases, and therefore they result in warming the Earth's atmosphere, because they are not allowing this energy, this heat energy, from escaping or leaving Earth. Now, if you've understood the role of greenhouse gases, what is the human effect in all of this? See, the atmospheric concentration of greenhouse gases has increased significantly over the past two centuries, largely due to human-generated carbon dioxide emissions from burning fossil fuels, and also due to deforestation, because trees help in removing many of these greenhouse gases, especially carbon dioxide, from the atmosphere. So what is happening? This increase has amplified the natural greenhouse effect by trapping more of the energy emitted by the Earth. This change causes the Earth's surface temperature to increase, and therefore we have something known as global warming. Due to this global warming, we have climate change. So with this, I hope you've understood what is greenhouse effect, what are the different aspects surrounding greenhouse effect. Let us move on to the next slide now. Now, what are the important greenhouse gases? Greenhouse gases means those gaseous constituents of the atmosphere, both natural and anthropogenic, those which absorbs and re-emit infrared radiations in the Earth's atmosphere. So we will briefly try and discuss each of these greenhouse gases, which are actually important when it comes to the greenhouse effect, when it comes to trapping of the energy which is re-emitted by the Earth. So first is water vapor. Now, water vapor is the largest overall contributor to the greenhouse effect, and humans are not directly responsible for emitting this water vapor in quantities sufficient to change its concentration in the atmosphere. However, carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases is increasing the amount of water vapor in the air by boosting the rate of evaporation. What I'm trying to say is that water vapor is one of the largest contributors to greenhouse effect. However, the concentration of water vapor in the atmosphere is not being increased directly due to human activities, but is being increased indirectly because we are causing global warming. This global warming is increasing the rate of evaporation, because of which the quantity of water vapor in the atmosphere has gone up. And this in turn will result in even more warming. However, I want you to know that unlike carbon dioxide, which can persist in the air for centuries, water vapor cycles through the atmosphere quickly. Evaporating from the oceans before coming back down in the form of rain or snow. Since the rate of evaporation rises with temperature, the amount of water vapor in the air at any one time is strongly related to the amount of other greenhouse gases in the air. So, as I mentioned earlier, the quantity of water vapor is directly not increased by human activities, but is indirectly influenced, is indirectly increased due to global warming. However, the quantity of water vapor, it changes. Most of, around 90% of the water vapor is present only in the troposphere. That is why this climate change, the, all of this is restricted only to the troposphere. You don't have it in higher upper layers of the atmosphere. Okay. Next, we'll discuss about carbon dioxide. Now, carbon dioxide is the primary greenhouse gas emitted through human activities. Carbon dioxide is naturally present in the atmosphere as part of the Earth's carbon cycle. So you have this natural circulation of carbon among the atmosphere, ocean, soil, plants and animals. The carbon cycle we have already discussed in one of the previous videos. However, human activities are altering the carbon cycle both by adding more carbon dioxide to the atmosphere and by reducing the ability of natural sinks like forests to remove carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. Now, while carbon dioxide emissions come from a variety of natural sources, human-related emissions are responsible for the increase that has occurred in the atmosphere since the Industrial Revolution. So, all of this I'm pretty sure everybody knows. So moving on, what are the main sources of carbon dioxide? Okay. What are the main sources of carbon dioxide being released into the atmosphere? One of the main sources is the combustion of fossil fuels to generate electricity. The other could be the combustion of fossil fuels such as petrol and diesel for transportation. Even many industrial processes emit carbon dioxide through fossil fuel combustion. Okay. So, the changes in carbon dioxide emissions from fossil fuel combustion are influenced by many factors, including population growth, economic growth, changing energy prices, new technologies, changing behavior, and even seasonal temperatures. If you consider the duration between 1990 and 2010, in this 20 years, the increase in carbon dioxide emissions corresponded with increased energy use by an expanding economy and population. So, whenever the economy develops, energy consumption also increases. This energy consumption results in more greenhouse gases being released into the atmosphere. So, now that carbon dioxide emissions have increased, it is also important for us to consider reducing or reduction of carbon dioxide emissions. See, when it comes to carbon dioxide emissions, the most effective way to reduce carbon dioxide emissions is to reduce fossil fuel consumption. That is the best way. Best way is nothing but to reduce the consumption of fossil fuels, because fossil fuels, the combustion or the use of fossil fuels are the major source of carbon dioxide. Other strategies such as energy efficiency, energy conservation, carbon capture and sequestration can also help in combating the concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. So, if this is clear, let us now move on to the next greenhouse gas, that is methane. Now, methane is emitted by natural sources such as wetlands, as well as human activities such as leakage from natural gas systems and also from raising of livestock, that is agricultural processes, are also responsible for the release and emission of methane into the atmosphere. The natural processes in soil and chemical reactions in the atmosphere help remove methane from the atmosphere. So, methane is generally released into the atmosphere how? Majorly due to human activities. However, natural processes in the soil and also in the atmosphere help in the removal of methane from the atmosphere. So, now if you wish to discuss the major source of methane, the major source of methane is of course human, but in up to some extent, you may also have a natural source. So if you have to discuss about the natural sources of methane, wetlands are the largest source emitting methane from bacteria that decompose organic materials in the absence of oxygen. So wetlands are the major natural source of methane. Smaller sources could also include oceans, volcanoes and wildfires, which also result in the emission of methane into the atmosphere through a natural process. Then you have human induced sources. As I mentioned, humans, man is a major source of methane being released into the atmosphere. So one of the most important human activity is agriculture, which results in a huge amount of methane being released into the atmosphere. In agriculture, domestic livestock such as cattle, buffalo, sheep, goats and camels produce large amounts of methane as part of their normal digestive process. Also, when animals' manure is stored or managed in holding tanks, methane is produced. However, globally, the agriculture sector is the primary source of methane emissions. Globally, you have to consider, if you consider agriculture is the primary source of methane emissions. Next, you can have industry. Methane is the primary component of natural gas. Okay, so obviously natural gas is used for mainly for production of energy and also maybe in other processes. So industrial activities are also responsible for methane release into the atmosphere. So what happens? Some amount of methane is emitted to the atmosphere during the production, processing, storage, transmission and distribution of crude oil and natural gas. Therefore, again, this is nothing but man-made activities. Similarly, some methane can also be released into the atmosphere from waste that is produced at homes and businesses. So we have already discussed about waste management, and when you have landfills, methane is generated in these landfills as waste decomposes and also from the treatment of wastewater. So if we are not managing our waste properly, this can also result in the release of methane into the atmosphere. So this sums up our discussion about methane. Next, we'll move on to nitrous oxide. Now, nitrous oxide is naturally present in the atmosphere as part of the Earth's nitrogen cycle and has a variety of natural sources. However, human activities such as agriculture, fossil fuel combustion, wastewater management and industrial processes are increasing the amount of nitrogen of dinitrogen oxide in the atmosphere. So again, when it comes to nitrous oxide, you can have natural source and human induced sources, but again, it is generally the human induced sources which are the primary source of nitrous oxide as a greenhouse gas in the atmosphere. However, let me just mention what are the natural sources. Natural sources of dinitrogen oxide or nitrous oxide are mainly from bacteria breaking down nitrogen in soils and oceans. This is nothing but a natural process which always takes place. However, if we artificially increase the nitrogen content in soil, this natural process also may be increased. So indirectly, we may be increasing the natural process, which results in the release of nitrous oxide into the atmosphere. Then, of course, we have human-induced sources. When it comes to human-induced sources, obviously, agriculture is the most important. Nitrous oxide is emitted when people add nitrogen to the soil through the use of synthetic fertilizers. Nitrous oxide is also emitted during the breakdown of nitrogen in livestock manure and urine, which contributes to 6% of the nitrogen emissions. Of course, with increase in agricultural activity, it would have increased beyond 6% in the last few years. Next, we have transportation. Okay, so nitrous oxide is also emitted in combustion of fuels, the fuels which are used in automobiles. So automobiles combusting fossil fuels will also result in the release of nitrous oxide, I'm pretty sure everybody knows this. We've always mentioned whenever we discuss about combustion of fossil fuels in automobiles, the release of nitrous oxide is one of the important gases which are released into the atmosphere. Then obviously you have industrial processes. Nitrous oxide is generated as a byproduct during the production of nitric acid, which is used to make synthetic commercial fertilizer. And in the production of many other, many other commodities, also nitrous oxide may be released into the atmosphere. Now, if you have to discuss about the removal of nitrous oxide is removed from the atmosphere when it is absorbed by certain types of bacteria or it is destroyed by ultraviolet radiation in the atmosphere through a natural process. So generally, the method of removing nitrous oxide from the atmosphere is nothing but natural process. Okay, so at present, even though humans are contributing to the increase in greenhouse gases, we are not able to reduce the concentration of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. I mean, think about it. How is it possible to reduce the concentration of so many gases from the atmosphere? Because these gases do not stay at one particular spot from which they are released. They spread out throughout the globe. Therefore, it is actually difficult, and it is best left to the natural processes to remove the greenhouse gases. And at the same time, we have to cut down or we have to reduce the emission of greenhouse gases so that we are able to bring the concentration of these gases into the atmosphere to its natural or its original balance. Next, we'll discuss about fluorinated gases. Now, fluorinated gases, these are emitted through a variety of industrial processes such as aluminium and semiconductor manufacturing and substitution for ozone depleting substances. Many fluorinated gases have very high global warming potentials relative to other greenhouse gases. Fluorinated gases are well mixed in the atmosphere, spreading around the world after they are emitted. However, if you have to discuss about the removal of fluorinated gases are removed from the atmosphere only when they are destroyed by the sunlight in the upper layers of the atmosphere. However, you have to note that in general, fluorinated gases are the most potent as it lasts the longest of all the greenhouse gases emitted by the human activities. They are able to remain in the atmosphere for a very, very long time, and hence therefore they are very potent when it comes to global warming. Here the three main categories of fluorinated gases are your HFCs, obviously your hydrofluorocarbons, then you have your PFCs, perfluorocarbons, and then your SF6, that is sulfur hexafluoride. So if I have to briefly describe or discuss about these HFCs, PFCs and sulfur hexafluoride, see, hydrofluorocarbons are used as what? They are used as refrigerants, they are used as aerosol propellants, solvents and also fire retardants. These chemicals were actually developed as a replacement for chlorofluorocarbons and hydrofluorocarbons because they do not deplete the stratospheric ozone layer. However, HFCs, that is hydrofluorocarbons, even though they have replaced chlorofluorocarbons and hydrochlorofluorocarbons, they are a potent greenhouse gas. Then if you have to discuss about perfluorocarbons, perfluorocarbons are compounds produced as a byproduct of various industrial processes associated with aluminium production and manufacturing of semiconductors. And also this PFCs also have a very high global warming potential. Then you have sulfur hexachloride. Sulfur hexachloride is used in magnesium processing and also in semiconductor manufacturing, as well as a trace gas for leak detection. These are where sulfur hexachloride is actually used. Now coming to black carbon. Now black carbon is a solid particle or aerosol which contributes to warming of the atmosphere. Black carbon, commonly known as soot, is a form of particulate air pollutant produced from incomplete combustion. This consists of pure carbon in several linked forms. So what are the sources? Sources are nothing but biomass burning, cooking with solid fuels, diesel exhaust. These are the major sources of black carbon. So what happens is, when black carbon is released into the atmosphere, black carbon warms the earth by absorbing heat in the atmosphere and also by reducing albedo effect, that is the ability to reflect sunlight when deposited on snow and ice. This black carbon is the strongest absorber of sunlight and heats the air directly. In addition, it darkens the snow, it darkens the snowpacks and glaciers through deposition, and also leads to melting of ice and snow. Also, you can make a note, black carbon can disrupt cloudiness and monsoonal rainfall and accelerates the mountain and accelerates the melting of mountain glaciers. However, black carbon stays in the atmosphere for only several days to several weeks, and hence the effects of black carbon on the atmosphere atmospheric warming and the melting of glaciers is not so potent when compared to other greenhouse gases, because they do not stay or remain in the atmosphere for a considerable period of time. Finally, we have brown carbon. Now, brown carbon is a ubiquitous and unidentified component of organic aerosol, which has recently come into the forefront of atmospheric research. These are nothing but light absorbing organic matter other than soot, which are present in the atmosphere in the form of atmospheric aerosols of various origins. Say, for example, it could be from soil humics or humic like substances or even combustion of fossil fuels. So the possible sources of brown carbon is nothing but biomass burning or smoke from agricultural fires. So brown carbon is generally referred to as greenhouse gases, and black carbon, which we had discussed earlier, actually represents to particles resulting from impure combustion such as soot and dust. So don't get confused. Black carbon may represent to soot, but brown carbon is usually a greenhouse gas on which more and more research is yet to be done for us to understand the true effect of brown carbon in greenhouse in global warming and to act as a greenhouse gas. So with this, we'll end our discussion about greenhouse effect and the greenhouse gases. I hope you've understood potential of these greenhouse gases as to how they can cause global warming and what is this greenhouse effect. So in the coming videos, we will discuss few other concepts surrounding this particular concept, so that the entire thing with respect to environment and ecology is clear to everybody. So thank you for watching. Please do subscribe and follow for more such videos.